Hello and welcome to the RC3, the Remote Chaos Experience on the R3S stage, the Remote Rhein-Ruhr stage. So today I have the honor of introducing JN with his talk about porting Linux to your favorite obscure ARM SoC. But before we go to that, we want you to tell us about things that are happening in the digital world, some things that you initiated or some things that you know about. And with that, please write us an email at newsshow@rc3.world or write us on our blog newsshow.rc3.world. Furthermore, this talk will be translated in German. Dieser Vortrag wird ins Deutsche übersetzt werden. Die Übersetzungen findet ihr unten im Video unter dem Reiter. Den Reiter weiß ich nicht mehr. Auf jeden Fall unten im Video werdet ihr das sehen. Furthermore, if you have questions, we want you contact us and tell us the questions due to the infrastructure right now. I cannot see you when you're standing in front of the microphone, so you can go either to Hackint, to the channel RC3-R3S, or you can write us on Twitter or Mastodon. The hashtag for that would be RC3-R3S. All threes are letters. All threes are numbers, or all threes are numbers. Or if the stream happens to cut out, we also stream to Twitch and YouTube. The link can be found by searching in the corresponding platform for Remote Rhein-Ruhr stage. If you are unsure how that is written, you can see the various titles of this video. So, about JN, I asked him, what should I tell about you? And I can only tell you what I know about JN. He is part of the Chaos community, and he certainly loves to hack some hardware. So give it up for JN and his talk, Porting Linux to your favorite obscure ARM SoC.
All right. As he said, I'm JN, and the slides have a bit of delay. So sometimes I find a piece of hardware that has embedded Linux on it, which is cool because we know Linux, we can do things with Linux. But then it has a really old version of the Linux kernel. Like this, for example, is the management controller in a Supermicro mainboard. Like a server mainboard, the thing that does IPMI and stuff, but it runs kernel version 2.6.17, which was released in 2006, 14 years ago. I'd rather have a modern kernel. So how do you go about that? First of all, you should collect basically all the information you can find about that chip you're interested in. Reference manuals, data sheets, source code that was released by the vendor. Like, due to the license of the kernel, the GNU General Public License, GPL, vendors have to publish their Linux source code. But sometimes you have to send them a request first. And sometimes you have to be really persistent with your request, so you get a source the source code tarball. It's also useful to look at other chips, which might be similar. For example, I searched for some of the register names in this chip, and I found a data sheet with descriptions for a different chip, which uses the same interrupt controller and Ethernet MAC. Finally, you should consider writing your own documentation, even if it's just to collect all the other information sources that you found in one convenient place. Yes. Right. The next thing to do is looking for serial ports. Most embedded devices that you can find have a serial port somewhere. It's very useful, especially in embedded devices that aren't particularly secure. You can just get a root shell if you connect a serial adapter to the right pins. They're usually not populated, so you have to search a bit. Like in this example, it's two pads of unpopulated resistors. So it's really small, but if you use an oscilloscope, you can find the right signal and then find your serial port. You can also find a bootloader shell sometimes, right? Slide transitions taking a bit again. Right, the bootloader is basically the first thing that runs when you power on anything. It's responsible for basic hardware initialization, like making sure that RAM is usable, and also for loading the actual operating system. But bootloaders often have debug facilities in them, so you can do interesting things with them. Like sometimes they have a menu of interesting commands, like peek and poke in memory, and load files from storage, like SD cards or flash. And you can even download data over network protocols, like TFTP. TFTP is terrible, but it works. And usually, when you have control over such a bootloader shell, you can also tell it to run your own code. So that's obviously very interesting if you want to run your own Linux kernel. But you should start simple. Like write the simplest possible program that can demonstrate code execution. For example, these four ARM instructions, they just load the address of the serial port, the UART, and load a character, and then repeatedly write that character to the serial port. And what it does, you can see on the right side, it just screams. And once you have that down, you could basically start running Linux. It won't be useful, but it will print something. But sometimes if the bootloader doesn't have all these interesting commands, it's useful to add your own little program that can do peek and poke and maybe some scripting and running code and whatever you need. Just so you have an interactive environment to experiment with the hardware. Right. So the next step is to configure Linux. The Linux kernel has this configuration system called kconfig, where you can configure all kinds of things. And if you just want a good basic configuration that's known to work on most systems, you use make arch equals arm multi v7 def config, or that's a different one for the older architecture versions. And then you can use make arch equals arm n config or menu config to configure all these options interactively. And because the def configs usually include all kinds of drivers, you most likely want to disable some of those drivers. And there's a few things that can help you in early debugging. For example, the config debug ll option. And if you enable that, you can also specify the UART base address and register width, so you can have a usable serial port there's an option for early print K, which just means you get lock messages earlier during boot. And there's another option to specify a built-in kernel command line, so the bootloader doesn't have to provide a reasonable command line. All right. Once you've configured and built Linux, you can use your bootloader to load the zimage file into RAM and run it. The zimage is a self-extracting compressed version of the kernel. But once you do that, you'll get something like this. It says invalid DTB or unrecognized unsupported machine ID, which basically means you need a thing called DTB. DTB means device tree binary, device tree blob. The device tree is a special data structure that describes to the kernel how the hardware is structured, at which addresses you can find which peripherals. How to write a device tree is defined in the device tree bindings, in documentation/device tree/bindings in the kernel source. And you write those device trees in DTS files for device tree source. They compile to DTB files, device tree blob. And if you want to use it now, you can enable another kernel option, which is config arm appended DTB. And then just concatenate the zimage and the device tree blob together into one file and give it to your bootloader so it runs those together. The kernel will then just find the device tree and use it. And it will boot a little further. Now, I did this and I got a problem. It booted about this far and then just stopped for no apparent reason. The reason was a bit difficult to debug. It turned out that the vendor kernel on this board uses only 100 megabytes of the RAM that is actually installed. Like, actually, the board has 128 megabytes, but some of it is used for something else that I haven't figured out. So that was really difficult to debug. But once I reduced the amount of memory that is used to those 100 megabytes, it worked without a problem. Right, and it got a little further until the point where it complains about no matching timers being found. Linux needs timer interrupts so it can schedule work, so it can switch between different tasks. Like, for example, when you run two programs in parallel. For timer interrupts to work, you need two things. First, you need a driver for your interrupt controller. An interrupt controller is a little piece of hardware just collects the interrupts from different peripherals on the chip and signals to the CPU that there was an interrupt. The code running on the CPU can then ask the interrupt controller, which interrupt was it, and acknowledge that the interrupt was received. And so it can just process the interrupts one by one. With older ARM CPUs, you had custom hardware from the chip vendor. In this case, it was Nuvoton. But with newer ARM CPUs, you will usually find that a generic part is used, the ARM GIC, generic interrupt controller. The next thing you need in order to get timer interrupts is a driver that tells the the timer hardware to generate interrupts. That's a clock event driver. There's something related in Linux called a clock source driver, which is just responsible for asking the hardware what time is it on a nanosecond scale. Then there's something else that also has clock in the name, which is the clock subsystem, spelled CLK. It manages basically everything that has a clock frequency. Like when you have a CPU that can run at different clock speeds on an ARM system where Linux runs, the different frequencies are managed through the clock system, clock subsystem, right? Sometimes when you specify a timer in device tree, it wants a reference to the input clock, so it can scale the frequency down correctly when it, so now it's which number to enter to wait for 2 seconds, for example. When you don't know how the clock hardware works, but you know the clock frequency, you can just make a dummy node in device tree and say compatible equals fixed clock and then enter the clock frequency and it will work for the moment. Now, once you have timer interrupts, Linux should boot to a panic, which is a success. We didn't have a panic before. It panics now because it says VFS unable to mount rootfs. It needs a file system, the root file system, where it can find programs to run. Because everything you do on a Linux system is basically in programs that are not the kernel itself, but those user space programs like init and a shell and wget or curl. Now, where do you store that root file system? At this point, you don't have a driver for any kind of storage, like SD cards or, I don't know, SATA. So you need to load the file system together with the kernel in something that's called an init RAMFS, initial RAM file system. And if you find the right kernel configuration option, you can then put this file rootfs.cpio into the kernel, so it's in the end just this one file, zimage.dtb, that you can load with a bootloader and run. Now, if you want to do this manually, just collect all the files that you need in a system, that's a bit tedious, but there are good options like buildroot, for example. Go to buildroot.org for more information, where you can just configure Linux user space with all the features you need. When you boot to user space, it's useful to specify on the kernel command line console equals tgy s0, comma 115200. It says the console, where the interaction happens, is the first serial port, and it runs at 115200 bauds. Otherwise, the kernel will just assume the wrong baud rate, and that's a bit difficult to debug. Right. Another useful driver is Ethernet. It's a bit more complex than the previous things like interrupt controllers and timers. Just because the hardware is a little more complex, usually. But it's very useful. Once you have Ethernet running or some kind of other networking thing, you can just use wget to download your kernel and then use kexec to run your kernel. So you don't have to deal with your bootloader anymore. You can basically use Linux as your bootloader now. Of course, there are many other functions in a typical system. But once you have the basic drivers, like for serial ports and timers and interrupts and stuff like that, it gets easier to just try different things. And you could let different people work on different parts of the chip because they don't depend on each other now. There's a lot of things that can go wrong. If you use the wrong kconfig settings, it might happen that all your programs crash. That happened to me. So it's better to start from a known good kconfig, a defconfig file, and not change any of the obscure things unless you just want to try out what happens when you change them. If you use RAM that is not actually available, weird things will happen. It's difficult to debug. If you don't specify a baud rate, you will get 9600, which is these days probably not what you want and not what you expect. I got stuck a dozen times during this project. So in the end, it still turned out to be useful, and I got through the problems that I had. So don't give up. You can do it. Right. When your kernel port works to some degree, you might think about bringing it to the official releases from kernel.org, which are released by Linus Torvalds and Greg Cage. Contributing to the upstream mainline Linux kernel works with patches and mailing lists. So you send an email with your change to the right mailing lists. They will try to give you a thorough review, tell you what's wrong with it. Then you send a second version, which has all these things fixed. And it iterates a bit. But in the end, it should get accepted. It's a bit tedious, but in the end, this is what should result in good quality code in the kernel. If you're interested in upstreaming, I recommend that you watch Greg Kroah-Hartmann's talk, write and submit your first kernel patch. All right, thank you for listening. All of the example code used in this project can be found on GitHub at neuschafer/WPCM450. For general discussions about kernel development, I recommend the double hash kernel IRC channel on Freenode. You can also find me on in the usual RC3 IRC channels later when I get home. All right. If there's any time for questions, I could answer questions now. And also, thanks to the stage crew who made it possible to speak here.
Entschuldigt die technischen Schwierigkeiten. Aufgrund der technischen Schwierigkeiten haben wir leider keine Fragen von vom Publikum. Und leider war der Stream auf meinem Ende auch nicht erreichbar. Das heißt, ich habe leider auch ich kann leider auch keine Fragen zu diesem Talk stellen. Aber vielleicht, was mich jetzt interessieren würde, wie hast du eigentlich, oder vielleicht auch unsere Zuschauer interessieren würde, wie hast du eigentlich mit dem, waren denn deine ersten Schritte in die Richtung, irgendetwas auf einem Arm, auf einem Armboard zu portieren, was du besessen hast und Linux drauf haben wolltest?
Okay, I'll translate to English because the talk was in English. What were my first steps in ARM and Linux on ARM? The first things I did on ARM were basically Did some hacking on my Nintendo Wii U, and I ran my own code in the service processor, which is an ARM CPU. My first steps in Linux on ARM were that I tried to port mainline Linux on an ebook reader that had a broken screen.
Jetzt sehe ich ein Video. Es scheint in Griff, man scheint, als ob man das in Griff kriegt, aber ich höre kein Audio. Okay, jetzt das Video wieder weg. Sieht ihr tatsächlich ein Video? Jetzt höre ich was. Hörst du mich?
Ja, ich höre dich.
Wunderbar. Genau, jetzt zu meiner Frage mal.
Ja, meine ersten Schritte mit irgendwelchem eigenen Code auf ARM waren, dass ich mit meiner Nintendo Wii U rumgespielt habe. Da gibt es so einen Service-Prozessor, der ein ARM-Prozessor ist. Da habe ich ein bisschen eigenen Code draufgebracht, aus Spaß. Und Linux auf ARM, das war, als ich versucht habe, einen eigenen Kernel auf einen E-Book-Reader zu bringen, der einen kaputten Bildschirm hat.
Okay, cool. Und dann willst du mit diesem E-Book-Reader, dann willst du den E-Book-Reader irgendwie arbiträr in deine Heimautomatisierung oder sowas einbinden, oder?
Ja, das wäre eine Option. Also
okay.
Ganz so konkrete Pläne habe ich da gerade nicht.
Okay, cool, freut mich. Genau, ansonsten, also wir haben leider immer noch keine Fragen aus der Community. Dann möchte ich mich an dieser Stelle bedanken. Wenn ihr JN irgendwie erreichen wollt, dann geht das garantiert über, dann ist das garantiert irgendwie auf GitHub verlinkt oder so.
Oder, ja, halt oder IRC in den üblichen RC3-Channeln auf Hackend.
Also sicher auch CCCAC-Channel, richtig?
Richtig.
Okay, wunderbar. Dann bedanke ich mich bei dir und entschuldige die technische Störung auf unserer Seite und ich hoffe, dass ihr dennoch diesen Vortrag genießen konntet. Damit zurück in die Pause.